Hi, welcome to Learning Monkey. I'm Vikram. In this class, we'll try to have an introduction to direct memory access and CPU bus signals for DMA transfer. So this is our third mode of transfer, which is what we call it as direct memory access. In our previous classes, we have covered about programmed I/O and interrupt initiated I/O. So before starting what is a direct memory access, we will try to understand, we'll try to have a recap of programmed I/O and interrupt initiated I/O. In the programmed I/O and the interrupt initiated I/O, what we have done is, whenever there is an for example, if you take this I/O device, so if this is I/O device and this is memory, this is main memory, so whenever we need to transfer, whenever an I/O device required to transfer some data onto the memory, or whenever the memory want to transfer some data onto the I/O device, so the transfer is done only through CPU. Only through CPU. In the programmed I/O, the CPU is going to continuously monitor the I/O device. Whenever the data is ready for transfer, so it is going to transfer the data through CPU. It is getting transferred onto the memory. Similarly, in the interrupt initiated I/O also, what we have done is, whenever the I/O device is ready for the transfer, it is going to interrupt the program execution of the CPU, and the CPU will go into the interrupt cycle. So after completion of the, for example, if it is running an instruction of a program, if it is in the middle of the instruction execution, so after completion of the execution of the instruction, the CPU will identify whether the interrupt is there or not. If there is an interrupt, it is going to shift into the interrupt cycle. So whenever the I/O device is having something for the transfer into the memory device, or if the memory device is having something to transfer onto the I/O device, so it is done through CPU. But in direct memory access, the name itself suggesting that direct memory access, the I/O devices are provided, the I/O devices can directly access the memory. So how it is going to be is, so this is how the transfer is done. So here a common bus to which this is memory, for example, if this is memory, the CPU and the I/O devices. So I/O devices means it is what we call it as I/O controller. So we are going to call it as a DMA, direct memory access controller. So this DMA controller will get connected to all the I/O devices. So whenever the I/O devices have something to transfer, so through I/O controller, so this is the bus that is used by memory, CPU and the I/O controller, I/O DMA controller, direct memory access controller. So this I/O devices and CPU will commonly access this bus, and the I/O devices will directly transfer the control onto the data onto the memory. If memory is having something to transfer, so that is directly transferred onto this I/O device, through which, so this is the controller through which it will get transferred onto the I/O devices. So this is how the direct memory access will work. So whenever the access to the bus is provided to the I/O devices, the CPU will sit idle. So the CPU will not function. So it will sit idle, and whenever the I/O devices, the I/O controller or the DMA controller is trying to access the bus, so then the data that is related to the I/O devices will be directly transferred to the memory. So this is how the direct memory access will work. But the difference is, there is a difference from this kind of transfer to this kind of transfer. The difference is, there are four phases in an instruction execution. So in an instruction execution, we have fetch phase, decode phase, and the next one is effective address phase, the effective address phase, and this is execute phase. So in all these four phases, so in our previous mechanisms like programmed IO or interrupt initiated IO, so after completion, for example, at the decode phase, if an interrupt has occurred, at the decode phase, if an interrupt has occurred, so what the CPU will do is CPU will complete all these phases, the execution of all these phases. After completion of these phases, all these execution of all these phases, after completion of execution of all these phases, then only the IO will be accessed. In the sense, the IO will be the IO instructions are going to be executed. But in the direct memory access, for example, if we are in the decode phase, if we are in the decode phase, so the CPU is going to stop wherever it is. So if it is in the decode phase, the CPU is going to stop its execution because they are separated from the execution. So the IO controller, the DMA controller, is going to have direct access to the memory. So whenever the CPU, if the CPU is in decode phase or any of these phases, it will stop at that point, and directly the bus access is provided to the DMA controller or IO controller. So this is what we call it as direct memory access controller. Even though it is in the middle of the execution of an instruction, the CPU is going to stop there itself, and the direct memory access control is provided, this DMA controller is provided with the access of this bus. The bus again consists of common lines, three different lines. One is data bus, address bus, and control lines. In the control lines, we are going to have read and write. So this is how the direct memory access will be. Now we will try to understand how that access is provided, how that access to the bus is provided. So that is provided by CPU bus signals for DMA transfer. So there are two bus signals that are provided to the CPU apart from the bus lines like data line, address line, read and write line. The CPU is provided with two pins. They are bus request and bus grant. So these are the lines. Based upon these lines, the CPU is going to provide access to the bus line. So the bus is provided to the IO controller or direct memory access controller by using these two pins. So how they are going to work is, for example, consider a direct memory access unit controller, DMA controller. So this is a DMA controller. So it is going to have again bus request and bus grant pin. So these are connected to the CPU. Whenever there is an interrupt by an IO device, the bus request will be activated. It will get transferred to the CPU bus request pin. With that, CPU identifying the bus request, what it will do is it is going to activate this bus grant. So what this bus grant is going to do is, whenever the bus grant is getting activated, these bus lines will be disabled. See here, high impedance disabled when BG is enabled. BG means bus grant is enabled. High impedance means these are the lines through which the data from the CPU will be transferred onto the bus. So this is what we call it as bus, right? So data bus, within the bus we are going to have data bus, address bus, read and write lines. So these lines will get disabled whenever the grant is getting activated. So first the DMA controller, whenever the input or output devices is having some data to transfer, so they are going to send that message to DMA controller. The DMA controller will request for the bus. So this will get activated. Whenever the request is made to the CPU, CPU immediately sends the bus grant request. Bus grant signal will be sent to the direct memory access controller. With that, this bus will be deactivated by the CPU, and this bus will now be activated by the direct memory access controller. Okay, so this is how the things will work. But how the transfer of data will be done by the DMA controller, how the transfer will be done is two ways we can make the transfer. One is burst transfer means at a time the some set of words will be transferred onto the bus line, and the next one is cycle stealing. So these two methods are very important to understand. So whenever the direct memory access controller is getting the access to the bus, how the transfer is done by the direct memory access controller? It is done in two different ways. One is burst transfer. Burst transfer means at a time, at a single point, at a single time. So all the data content will be transferred onto the bus line. So for which kind of devices this burst transfer will be good is for the devices which run very fast. In the sense, if you take hard disk is the speed, is the very fastest device which can transfer the data between the memory, main memory, and the hard disk unit. So such kind of devices which can transfer the data very fast, the burst transfers will happen. The second method is cycle stealing. So what this cycle stealing means is, there are some devices which are going to transfer very slow. For example, if you take keyboard, so at most how many keys we can press in a second? In a key we can press in a second we can press at most 5 keys. So for those 5 keys we have to make the CPU to wait for 1 second, which is not required. Because so what this cycle stealing will do is, for the devices which are slow in the transfer of data, what it will do is, we are going to use this cycle stealing, which means that one of the clock cycle of the CPU will be given to the IO device, DMA controller. So the DMA controller is going to take one cycle of the CPU, because the data transfer is very slow. CPU works at nano instructions per second. For the transfer of 1 byte of data onto the memory, we are going to take only 1 cycle. As the keyboard is taking, as the keyboard is capable of transferring five to six keys in a second, within that second, 1 cycle out of million clock cycles, we are going to give 1 cycle, so that the transfer from keyboard to memory will happen. See the fast 1 second, it may look easy, very simple for us, but nanoseconds, understand about that. Out of those nanosecond part of the execution of the instruction, 1 second is very high. Okay, so now what this cycle stealing is, whenever there is a request by slow speed devices like keyboard, so we are going to steal one of the clock cycle of the CPU. One clock cycle of the CPU will be provided by the CPU. So after one clock cycle, this bus grant will be disabled, and this bus request will also get disabled. So after some time, whenever the key is pressed again, the same process will repeat. See here. So after the transfer, if it is hard disk is capable of reading or writing the data very fast. Because of its capability, we are going to take the burst transfer. So the bus can be used by the DMA access in two different ways for the transfer of data between the DMA controller and the memory. One of the ways is burst transfer for high speed devices, and the other one is cycle stealing for keyboard. Very low speed devices like keyboard. Okay, so this is just an introduction, and we have understood about one of the component one of the components, CPU pins, we have understood. In the later coming videos, we are going to understand piece by piece. Finally, we are going to understand the entire block diagram of DMA structure. So DMA, how, what are the different components that we are going to have and how they are connected and how the signals will be transferred. So all that content by the end of this section, by the end of this, we are going to take 2 to 3 videos. We are going to divide each component separately and we are going to understand them individually. In the final video, we are going to interconnect all those devices and we are going to get the complete idea about how the DMA will work. Okay, so hope you got the clarity on this concept. Thanks for watching. If you haven't subscribed to our channel, please subscribe to our channel and press bell icon for the latest updates. And if you have any doubts regarding this concept, please post your doubt in the comment section below. And if you feel that this video is helpful to you, please give us a like symbol and please share this video with your friends so that they will also get benefited. Thanks for watching.